Seek the Lord in prayer. Eternal Father and friend, we thank you for your goodness towards us. We thank you for bringing us here this morning. And in spite of the loss of a loved one, we are here with the assurance that one day it will be proven that death is not the end. You are coming to resurrect your children and to take them home with you. It is our hope this day that someone will be among the number when the saints go marching home. We ask that you'll bless the family. Pray that the Holy Spirit will be with each one. You'll bind them with the cords of love that cannot be broken, and you'll fill them with your love and with your spirit. Be with all those that come by to comfort them. May the service of the day bring joy and gladness to our hearts in spite of the loss of a father, a grandfather, etc. We ask, Lord, that you will intervene and bring joy and happiness to each soul. May the service go uninterrupted, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Right, we will now have our opening hymn. You may be seated. Okay, the program would continue and announce, starting with the first scripture reading.
Firstly, I just want to thank you all for being here. It's lovely to see your faces. And on behalf of my family and I, again, we just want to say thank you. So I'm going to read this scripture, Revelations 21, verse 1 to 7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Thank you.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. Solemn occasion. I used to sing with Simon, argued Simon. He was a unique man. You know, I'm here, we're all the same here. Pay tribute to the family and his daughters, and Janet, and everybody. We used to sing in the same group together, me, him, and Dennis. So I thought that I'd represent in that way as a dear friend and a brother, and all the kindness that he's shown to me, just the least that I could do for him.
Why should I feel discouraged? And why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and hope? When Jesus is my portion, and I know he watches me, and I sing because I'm happy, and I sing because oh.
Good morning, church. That was a long walk. I'm standing in this position firstly because I'm a part of Simon's history. I was his wife, the mother of his four children, his confidant, his best friend, his advisor, he's everything. In the last few years of Simon's life, he was consumed with how people saw him, what people thought of him, and who he was. And in the last years, last months even, one of his questions to himself repeatedly was, who am I? Who is this? Is this Simon Edwards? Is this Simon Edwards? And he would repeat that again and again and again. And at the height of his, I'm going to hit it on the head, poor mental health, that was his words. Is this Simon Edwards? One thing Simon wanted me to do was to tell his story. And he always said to me, Janet, you know me more than anybody else in this world. And when I die, I want you to give me a good funeral, and I want you to tell the world who I am. And that's why I'm here today. So I'm going to tell you Simon's story from my perspective. It's only a very short synopsis, but I hope that it'll open your eyes to who Simon is. And I will not speak about him in the past. Simon and I met 43 years ago. It was on my journey to and from William Neave Memorial High School, where I was a student. Simon, who was 2 years my senior, had recently started work as a young office junior at Long Pond Sugar Factory. Most mornings, and again in the evenings, our paths would cross. I soon grew to learn that our meetings were not coincidental, but they were totally orchestrated by a young man who was attracted to a fine-looking coolie girl. We became friends, and eventually we were a couple. Simon was age 19, and I was 17, when we welcomed the birth of our first daughter, Simone. Shortly after that, Simon decided to return to his birthplace, London, and with the help of his aunt, Editha Watson, and his cousins, his family here, they helped to make a way for him to return. When Simon came here, his dream, his desire, his greatest wish was for me and Simone to join him. Shortly after, we were here, 10 months later. 1 month after arriving, we were married. I was 18 years old, Simon was 20 years old. We shared years of marriage, love, a good partnership, and we made a great team. Simon was a gracious provider and a fierce protector, but we also had heartaches and pain. Disadvantaged by our very young age, our naivety, our lack of experience, the support and directions from older people, our human imperfections prevailed, and we struggled to navigate the pitfalls of marriage. With our weak defenses and no buffer, the devil saw his opportunity and stepped in bold and audacious, taking our marriage, our home, the beautiful family we had created, and for a good few years, Simon's relationship with God. The devil also took his peace of mind, and no matter how he smiled, true happiness was far from him. Simon struggled with immense guilt and pain because of his choices and wrong decisions. He felt that he would always be judged and seen in a negative light. Although we parted over 25 years ago, we were never apart. We remained best friends. I was his helper, his confidant, his advisor, the person at the other end of the phone when he needed to talk. He'd ring me on Friday nights when he missed his family worship and the way that we'd welcome in the Sabbath together. He'd ring me on special holidays such as Christmas because the memories he had of those special times with us as his family would hit him forcefully. Simon was diagnosed with MS, and as the effects of MS ravaged his body, I helped him research possible cures, new inventions, positive ways to live with the illness. I attended appointments with him when he needed support, spoke with his consultants on his behalf, and helped him understand when he did not have the capacity to. I was his advisor. We spoke a lot about his feelings, and even more than the pain of his illness was the pain he felt at having left his marriage and his family. Heartbroken and contrite, he begged forgiveness of myself and our girls. He was desperate to make things right with God, and therefore he felt that he needed to make things right with us first. Simon's regular request was that, like I said, when he dies, that I should speak for him. Last year, we went through a phase where he begged me, please can I write what I'm going to say? And he would ask me this almost every week for months. And I'd say, no, I'm not doing that. Categorically refused, that's not gonna happen. And that's because I didn't know that today would come. But here I am today. So true to the task at hand, who is Simon? I choose to describe him as S, sharp, sophisticated, sociable, I, industrious, M, meticulous, O, organized, and N, nifty and notable. Simon was loved and admired for his charm, his charisma, sense of fashion, the cheeky twinkle in his eye, and mischievous grin on the corner of his mouth. He was a magnet for the ladies, and he reveled in that. He could talk the hind legs off a donkey. He was opinionated and enjoyed a debate, anytime, any place, and he never backed down until he got his point across. Or he'd agree to disagree, especially when it came to the Bible discussions and the Sabbath. Simon was an old, wise man in a young person's body. Most importantly, Simon loved God, and he sought to rekindle and build a deeper relationship with his Savior. It was a joyful day when he recommitted his life to God in July 2021 and was rebaptized. Simon has since lived as a single man in the transformed existence. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. It is not Simon that we bury today. It is just the body. His soul is gone back to God from whence it came. And Simon will live on through all of us in the many stories that we have to tell of how he's touched our lives, in his children, his four daughters, and our three grandchildren. And when others come, they too will know about the person they had as a grandfather. All I can say to you today is that we are all in line behind Simon. We just don't know where our place is and what our place is. And I beseech you to live as if it's your last day. Simon had no idea that on the day he went, that he would have gone on that day. It was unexpected. It beholds us then to live for God, live right, love each other, forget about the malice and the strife, and that when God comes, we too can be in that number when the saints go marching in. Rest in peace, Simon, and I look forward to meeting you on that great getting up morning when God himself shall call forth for his saints to come forward. Thank you.
Lily of the valley, let your sweet aroma fill my life. Rose of Sharon, show me how to grow in beauty in God's sight. Fairest of 10,000, make me a reflection of your light, Lord of your light. Days are shining on me, let your love shine through me in the night.
Show me what I've never seen. Beautiful singing, amen. Just want to express my appreciation and gratitude to the family to have this section in the funeral, to share a few words with us this morning. I know that, although I'm the pastor here for Brixton Church, that Simon used to attend the Brixton Church. I believe this was his first church that he attended, and then went on to Croydon Church, and it's good to see the Croydon representatives that are here today from the Croydon Church. And it was whilst he was at Croydon that I got to know Simon, and while I was the pastor there, and we had some interesting times reasoning together and discussing the Bible, and as was mentioned, he can be opinionated. And so sometimes we had some good back and forth discussions. But at heart, he loved the Lord and he wanted to do what was right for the Lord. And I'm glad to know that in 2021, that he got baptized. That is a great testimony that he made that decision for Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, Simon's passing, it was sad for me to hear this, and in relative terms, he passed away still as a young man, you know. But it reminds us when we, on occasions like this, about life, and it was mentioned in the tribute that life, we don't know what tomorrow will bring for any one of us. In fact, the Bible talks about the fickleness of life. And in James chapter 4 and verse 14, it likens life to just like vapor. It says, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a vapor that appears for a while and then vanishes. In Psalms 144 and verse 4, the psalmist likens life like the breath. And he says that man is like a breath. His days are like a passing shadow. In Psalm 78 and verse 19, he likens our lives to like the wind. And the psalmist says, he remembered that they were but flesh, a wind that passes and comes not again. And so when we read these scriptures, we'll find that indeed life is uncertain. We're living in an uncertain world. We're living in a time when, even now, there's a lot of uncertainty. In the Middle East, we see the crisis taking place. In the Ukraine, Russia, we see wars taking place. We see people are fearing their lives, or the people are fearing for the future. And we're living in a time when people are looking for answers, and they're looking for a way out, and they're looking for some kind of direction. And the truth is that God created every one of us he created us perfect, but he created us with a void, something in our lives that needed to be filled. And the whole purpose of our journey in life is to find that one thing that can fill that void. But you find that a lot of people search for different things to fill that void. Some people look for love in the wrong places to fill that void. Some people get into different activities or habits to fill that void. With all the time, the only one who can truly fill that void and to complete us is God Himself. That is the whole purpose of life. It is to know who God is. And in our journey of life, if we miss that opportunity, then we've missed the whole purpose of life. The journey and purpose of life is to know the one person that can fill that void. I'm glad Simon found that person. But not only that, but we also find that if there's ever a time to evaluate our lives, it is in times like this. Simon's untimely death ought to be a time for us to think about our own lives. Where are we going? What is my direction? What path am I on? How is my life? Am I truly happy living my life? Do I have peace in my life? This is a time for us to reflect on these things. And in the midst of our sadness and grief, to make sure, as the Bible says, that we are on the right direction, heading into the right destiny. There are only two destinies in life. And we need to be heading in the right direction, in the right destiny. You know, it's the times like this when we think about living in a peaceless world, that we often say things like, "May Simon rest in peace," as was mentioned today. And I believe that Simon is resting in peace because he found the God of peace. And I want to say to us today that this world cannot give us peace. It can only promise peace, but cannot give peace. We all know that. Politicians will say what they have to say. They will sign peace treaties. They will do what they have to do in order to, with the appearance that there is peace. But this world cannot give peace the way we need peace in our lives. And I want to say to us today that in order for us to rest in peace, we have to live in peace. I'll say that again. In order for us to rest in peace, we have to live in peace. Because once we live in peace, when our time comes, we will rest in peace. But if we're not living in peace, then the rest will be uncertain. And so this peace that we need is not a peace, as I mentioned, that this world gives. In fact, the Bible tells us in John chapter 14, verse 7, it says, "Peace I leave with you." That's Jesus Christ. "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you," Jesus says. "I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid." That's what Jesus says. So Jesus is the one that gives us this peace. So how can we get this peace? How can we live a life of peace in a chaotic world? I remember when I was studying for the ministry, I went to what was then known as West Indies College, now North Caribbean University in Mandeville in Jamaica. And I'll never forget my first day arriving on campus, living and being born in England and living in England, and then going to Jamaica and going to the men's dormitory where I'll be staying, spending 4 years of studying. And as I approached the men's dormitory, it looked like a very unsightly building. It was just four stories of a slab building. There was nothing attractive about this building. And it had metal louvered windows. It almost looked like a prison. And I thought to myself, I'm going to have to spend 4 years in this place. And I was on the fourth floor looking around everything. And then there were four of us in one room. And there I was thinking, I'd left my lovely home to come to a place like this. But in 1988, when I was there, a hurricane, Gilbert, came through that island from the east coast of Jamaica to the west coast, traveling at 140 miles per hour, winds lashing at a speed unknown. And I was in this building, in this that I had disdained, But as I looked through the metal louvers, I could see the palm trees bending in the with the force of the wind, and I could see the zinc roofs coming off the homes. And I could see the debris and people scurrying and rushing and hiding. There was chaos outside. But because this build was on a solid rock, solid foundation, because this building, although it didn't look sightly, it was solid and strong, and everything around me was in chaos, but where I was total peace. I was safe. I looked at those windows, it was chaos, but where I was, it was calm. And that brought home to me what peace really is all about. Peace is when everything around you may be chaotic that you cannot control, but the one thing you can control is what goes on in your heart. And the one thing you can control is when Jesus comes into our hearts, he can give us that peace that passes all understanding. When everything around you is chaos, you're calm and you're at wholeness in your mind because you know where you're going and you know whose you belong to. And I say to us today, friends, that this peace is what God wants us to have. We can't control the chaos, but we can control how we respond to the situations in our lives. And the first thing that we have to do in order for us to have this peace, the first thing that we have to do on our journey in life, which we don't know when it will end, so that's why the Bible says today, if you hear my voice, today is the only time that we have. And so the first thing we have to do is make peace with God. Make peace with God. Romans 5 verse 1 says, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God. When we are justified by faith, in other words, when we know that everything in our past, we've asked God to forgive us, we're on the right path, we've made amends with God, that our lives with God is in a good place. We've made peace with God. It's not that God is angry with us, but he wants us to acknowledge that we cannot live life without him. And we have to come to that understanding that every new day that we wake up, it is God who gives us the breath to see that day. Every new day that we wake up, it is a gift of life that God has given to us that we should not take for granted. Every new day we wake up, we ought to be able to say, thank you, Jesus, for a new day. Because many people didn't make it through that night. And so God wants us to be at peace with him. To know that there is nothing between us and our Savior. When we have peace with God, I can tell you, you will have a calmness, you will have a comfortableness in your life because you know and that everything is okay. You can sleep well, your conscience is clear. But not only that, but the Bible also says that once we make peace with God, we have to also make peace with others. Romans 12 verse 18 says, if it is possible, and as much as it depends on you, live peaceably with all people. And that means that we have to come to the point that we cannot hold grudges one with another. We cannot have malice between one with another. We cannot have unforgiveness between one with another. We cannot have hatred between one with another, because if we harbor all those things in our lives, who's gonna come off the worst? It is gonna be you. And so we have to recognize that life is precious, life is a gift, and we cannot go around harboring enmity amongst us, whether it's amongst friends or family or church people. We have to know that as much as it's possible with you, be at peace with your brother or your sister. Be at peace with them. I believe that if there is one thing, and knowing Simon, that if there is one genuine thing that he would have wanted, is that those who are here today, all of us here today, that we have no discord amongst ourselves. He would not like it to know if there were fractions amongst us. He would not like to know that he has left behind loved ones who are squabbling with each other. And so we have to respect his legacy and the desire that he wants that we live in harmony with each other. And so if Nelson Mandela, who spent, 28 years in prison, in captivity, and when he came out, he became the president of South Africa on his inauguration, when he had ample opportunity to get revenge against his captives, he says those powerful words, he says, let bygones be bygones. And sometimes we have to do that too. Make peace with God, make peace with other people, and lastly, make peace with yourself. Sometimes we are our own worst enemies, and we make mistakes in the past, and we tend to feel that we live a life of regret because of what we've done in our past, but we can't change the past. God is a forgiving God, and we have to move forward, but we have to make peace with ourselves. Learn to forgive yourself. And Jesus is the only one who can do that for us. And so I say to us today, make peace with God. Make peace with our brothers and sisters and your family. Make peace with yourself. Live a life that counts. Let our lives be truly a joyful life, even in a joyless world. And Jesus is the expert in all things. This late story is told of a grandmother who was looking after her grandson, little boy. And where she lived out in the country, she discovered that her son, who wasn't too well, needed some medication. And so she had to go into the town to the chemist to buy the medication for her son. And as she drove into the town with a small car, she came out, got the medication she needed for her grandson. And then when she got back to her car, she realized that she had left the keys in the car. And she tried to open it, but all the doors were locked. And in her frustration, knowing that her son needed the medication, she cried out in prayer. She said, Lord, please send somebody to help me to get the keys out of the car. And she tried all her best, but nobody was able to help. And so she cried out to God. And as she had finished her prayer, this man on a motorbike came by, a biker with his leather jacket tattooed and everything, rough looking, drove up by, and he saw the woman in distress and asked if he could help her. And she said, yes, I've left the keys in my car. Could you please help me? And so this man was able to get a piece of wire. He prized it through. And within a few minutes, he got the latch open. The door was open. She said, thank you, Jesus. He said to him, thank you. You're such a good man. You're such a wonderful man. And gave him a hug. And he prized her fingers away. And she said, I'm not a good man. I've just spent 6 years in prison. And she said, well, what did you do? And he said, I was in prison for breaking and entering. The old lady raised her hand to the sky and said, thank you, Jesus. Not only did you answer my prayer, but you sent me a professional. I say to us friends that in the time in which we live today, we have a professional. His name is Jesus Christ. Bible says, with man this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. And so whatever we're going through, whatever challenges we're facing, we have an expert in Jesus Christ who is able to take us through. Let us never forget that the God that we serve is able to do all things. And this professional Jesus Christ says these words. He said in John 14, 1-3, let not your hearts be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, and I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again, receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That was Simon's belief. He believed that Christ would come again. Let that be our belief too. That as we hold on to Jesus and believe in him and allow him to fill us with that peace, one day soon when Christ comes, when that resurrection takes place, we will see Simon again. And what a wonderful reunion that will be. Let nothing separate us from having that peace of God. Amen.
Good morning, all. I first must give honor to the Holy Spirit. I greet all the leaders in their respective places. I greet all family and friends. My deepest condolences, or should I say our deepest condolences, to the Edwards siblings and Simon's children. It's a very sad but joyous occasion because Simon was in the Lord. And so on behalf of the Watson family and myself, receive our heartfelt condolences. And our scripture reading will be taken from Titus chapter 3, verse 4 to 7. When God, our Savior, revealed his kindness and love, he saved us, not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He washed away our sins, given us a new birth and new life through the Holy Spirit. He generously poured out the Spirit upon us through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Because of his grace, he made us right in his sight and gave us confidence that we will inherit eternal life. And now we're going to see a slide of Simon Levi Edwards as he rededicates his life to Jesus Christ through water baptism. And it's with a song featuring Simone, his eldest daughter, singing Amazing Grace alongside her father. Amen.
He's a philosopher, he's a theologian, he's a financier. And any subject that comes on the men's ministry, Simon doesn't comment. A good soul.
Very good.
Very good.
Very good.
And it is in a pastor, it's our pleasure. You know, as we lay him down, that the Lord will bring him up. And that Simon, the skills that he has, will continue to use for the glory of God.
And portion me. Yeah. My most memory about Simon Edwards is that I went to Langpan and I meet him about 84. And I remember when I came to Langpan to get a job there, he's the one who looked the job for me, he's the one who do the interview for me and get me the job at Langpan. He was a messenger at the factory, pick up the mails and so. And I'm telling you, this guy is amazing. Everybody at that workplace loved this guy up to the very day he had leaving. It was a neatest guy working at that office there. Neat, I'm not telling you, him just neat. When he's not working a week, in the weekend time, he come to the machine shop to get a skill in the machine shop, and he has to check me, CMPS in there. So he leave the office, weekend time, come to the machine shop, learn a skill there. And up to when he leave Langpan and went by London, he was one of my best friends, not my friend, he's coming like he's my brother. My most memory about this guy, you know, is that he came to Jamaica and he was selling some clothes, asking me if I can go with him to go around and sell some clothes. I said no, because I don't really like those stuff. Anyway, I said, towards him, I'm going with him. And I'm telling you, man, we went to Bendong, Falmouth, Tapshilani, and everywhere this guy went. And when we set up our stall, people from Montego Bay, they walk. I remember this guy from Montego Bay, every Friday, Wednesday, we have to be beside him. And I remember him died now. I remember every time we go there, they look into Simon and come across. When Simon set up his things to sell, everybody come across this guy. And look, even me, when we pack up the things them, Simon said, no, it's not so, Paul. The guy was so neat in everything what he done. Neat, I'm not telling you, saying neat, neat. The very thing them what we set up, the tent what we set up, and it, the way set the ladies things them, this guy was amazing. I mean, he speak to people and then come over. I remember people from Hanover, Westmoreland, come at Bendong, go and look at that guy to buy things from him. And as we said to him, says, hey, man, boy, I rate you. You're good, man. You're good like a girl. Yeah. He was so loving. I know enough people know here some dead and who here. He was so... Everywhere we went, people always say, if me is him father, I would tell them, no, I'm brother. So, oh, where is him, bro? Simon, there's a lot of things to talk. You know, that Simon came to my house, you know. And when he came to my house, him and my wife, as we have a discussion about the Bible. And my wife couldn't manage him. Because that man, he knew the Bible from the back to the end. From the front to the back, he know the Bible. And you couldn't touch him but religious. That man have to look in the Bible to quote a scripture and tell you. That man he have a Christianity in him, deep, deep, deep. And, you know, I know he's gone a place to rest. And may his family, I know his family miss him so much. But, you know, may his soul rest in peace, the good Lord above us. Thank you.
Hi, Janet and family. On behalf of my family, Robert, myself, and Therese and Leanne, we want to extend our deepest condolences In addition, we want to extend our condolences to Simon's siblings and the rest of his family. We know that this is a difficult time with the passing of Simon, who was a great family friend and a brother in the Lord.
Yeah, knowing Simon, Janet and the girls was a wonderful experience for me and my family. And I remember with great fondness the Sabbath lunches, the fellowship, the food. You know, they were great times and I am so grateful for them. One of the things I particularly remember about Simon is that Simon knew how to dress. Man, that man's suits were sharp. Even the lining of his trousers was as sharp as a razor. Simon also had a beautiful passion for singing. I used to sing in a quartet with Simon, Dennis Newell, Tony Monroof, and myself. And we used to sing songs like Jesus Gave Me Water, Don't Know Much About History, Stand By Me. You know, they were wonderful times, and I will never forget them. But what I greatly admire about Simon is his tenacity. His tenacity in business. He was never ashamed to try something new. And I remember when Simon took it upon himself to sell some gold-lined Dutch pots in which he would tell you that, listen, if you don't eat food cooked out of these pots, the food will not taste the same. And, you know, there were wonderful times.
You are all in our thoughts and our prayers. I know he was going to be, he was so proud of his daughters, each one of you. And for you, Janet, you've been an amazing mum, a great example. His memory will live on, but it will live in the memory and the lives of each of you, his daughters. So we're praying for you all.
Amen. I want to thank God for the hope in Christ. In the resurrection. And we know that one day, by the grace of God, we will see Simon again. And when we see him again, we're going to hear him sing the song, "When I left my sins behind, way down by the riverside." And we'll all join in, thanking God for what he did for us.
Amen.
You know, because of the blessed hope, it makes a massive difference. And my prayer, our prayer for you all, is that God be with you and give you the strength as you go through this very difficult time.
Yeah.
Amen.
God bless. Bye-bye.
On July 31st, 2021, Simon, you sent me a message asking me to pray for you because you would have been at that time burying the old man in baptism. I remember when I saw that message, my heart was filled with so much joy because it's something that we've always spoken about, always encouraging you. I know that it's something that your heart longed for, and that's to recommit your life to your Maker and your Savior. And I shared in that joy, celebrating when you made that decision. And I know that heaven was rejoicing when you made that decision to recommit your life to your Savior and your King. It's still very surreal that you're no longer here. What has been helping me through this experience, it's just the memories of who you were as a person, a man that loved God, a man that hungered and thirsted to be one and to be right with your Savior, a man that had a heart that was filled with compassion, filled with love for people, and always want to encourage someone to trust God and to put Christ first. You believed in his word. You believed in his prophecies that solidify who he is. You poured a lot of that in me. You poured so much of God's word in my life. And today I can say, because of your ministry, because of you ministering to me, that those seed have borne fruit in my life. And I am eternally grateful for that. A memory of you keeps coming to my mind. When in Jamaica, there was this man that we were just driving, and you saw this man on the street that was bleeding out because he was stabbed, and everybody was just looking at him. You couldn't pass. You stopped the car and you grabbed your beach towel and you held that man in your arms, even though you didn't know him. And you wrapped his wound and you stayed there with him, with this stranger, until help came on the scene. That's the person that I remember you to be. One that your heart is always going out for people. And that's the person I will always remember you to be, Simon. I will really miss though we didn't talk as often anymore, I'll just really miss hearing you saying, "Hi, Kimberly." And I would say, "Hey, Simon." My last conversation with you, you told me that you were doing a lot better. You know, I know you were going through some stuff, but you sounded so positive and so optimistic. And I felt good because I heard a smile in your voice. And it's the last time I spoke to you. That's my last memory of your voice. And it will stay with me. I look forward now to that great getting up morning. You've always said to me, it's never over until the fat lady sings. And the fat lady has sang. But I know, my dear brother, my friend, and one of my confidants, that I believe in my heart, that you will be among the number on that great getting up morning. And I pray that we will see each other again on that day, as we stand before our Savior, our Maker and our King. Death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? We thank God for the resurrection and the life. You have lived. You have lived. I just want to send condolences to all your family members, to your children who have to endure this burden. I pray that God will just provide comfort. I pray, Janet, that God will strengthen you during this time. I pray, Simon's mom, auntie, all the siblings, I just pray that God will strengthen you guys, and that you all will just celebrate Simon for the amazing and dignified person that he was. Simon, may your memory continue to live on. You've impacted many lives. And I just say today, sleep on, my friend. Sleep on. Until that day when you hear, "Simon, come forth." You are definitely missed.
He is no one.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of my dad, I feel truly honored to see all of your faces here today. In this dash that we call life, none of us truly know how many days, hours, or minutes are given, are gifted to us. One thing that everybody knew my dad for was his sentiment where love was concerned. This life journey that we behold in front of us started with love and ended with love in its many forms over its many days, weeks, months, and years. My sisters and I stand together as evidence, as the legacy of the love that was poured through from our dad, Simon Levi Edwards. My name is Simone. I'm the first of Simon's four daughters. These are my sisters, Monique, Crystal, and Chantal. We want to thank you all for coming today to honor and celebrate our father's life. I'm honored to present his eulogy, and so I read. Simon Levi Edwards was born on the 20th of October, 1964, in the Jeffreys Road Lying-In Hospital in Clapham, SW4. He was the fifth child of parents Albert and Gorgel Edwards. At an early age, his parents returned to live in Jamaica, taking him with them. They resided in the parish of Manchester, a small rural area called Waterloo. At around age two, his father's sister met and fell in love with this little handsome nephew and asked if she could take him to Trelawney to live with her. Daddy grew up with his aunt and her husband and believed them to be his parents. At age 14, he was suddenly told that he was being taken home to his parents and siblings. He was very confused and shocked, and when he arrived, he was surprised to see several siblings all eagerly waiting to meet him. He stayed in Manchester approximately 2 years with desperate anxiety to one day return to Trelawney. The day came when this finally happened and he returned to Clarkstown, Trelawney. Not long after his return, at approximately age 16, Daddy was offered an office assistant position at the Long Pond Sugar Factory. There he worked Monday to Friday and was well loved by everyone he came in contact with. Daddy was popular and admired for the person he was in Clarkstown, and many young people looked up to him and wanted to emulate him. He was handsome, and I'll proudly say, a magnet for the females. At age 17, Daddy met our mother, who was age 15 at the time. At 19, Dad and Mum welcomed their first child, me. And soon after, Daddy decided to return to England, where he believed he and his new little family would have better opportunities. Daddy arrived here in England on the 10th of May, 1984, to his father's sister, Auntie Dieta Watson, and her family. Daddy quickly integrated into UK life and started his first job working at Rosewell Management Services in London's West End. He started attending Mount Hermon Church, where he was very active in the church and loved by his church family. His greatest desire was to have his family join him. And 10 months later, in February 1985, Daddy's dream came true. Dad and Mum were married on the 2nd of March, 1985. And in 1986, they welcomed my sister, Monique, and subsequently my other sisters, Crystal and Chantal. Dad was an entrepreneur who tried his hand at several business ventures. He was always a busy man in constant motion, but never too busy to share his love of life with those around him. He was helpful, kind, and he would go above and beyond to assist those in need. Whether it was offering someone a lift, you know, just a memory comes to mind of him driving me to school and stopping at bus stops to pick up anyone that wore the same school uniform as me, whether they were a friend or not. You know, and then he also offered practical and physical help to anyone that needed it. Daddy taught us all to love people and be helpful, grounded in the word of God and our purpose to humanity. He taught us from the Bible and centered us a lot around the book of Proverbs. For the time that Daddy was with us, he was a dedicated family man. He was always there when we needed him. He loved music and singing. Sundays while ironing, he danced to soca. His beautiful tenor voice always echoed in our ears. Daddy would play Sam Cooke almost on a continuous loop. And he'd often perform in church his best rendition of Lily of the Valley. Daddy was the light of our lives. For me as a little girl, I remember him making me laugh so much. You know, he'd tickle us until we almost cried. I remember him telling us stories at bedtime. He seemed to have endless Anansi stories, followed by Jamaican folk lullabies. He wasn't one for harsh words or punishments, but he instead would quote scripture in his desire and his commitment to teaching us what was right. For us as his children, our grief is compounded. We've had to grieve our dad twice. This time, God saw it fit to take him home to rest. Daddy's burden towards the end of his life was heavy, and it was time for him to lay it down. In his lifetime, Daddy was a son, a husband, a father, a granddad, a brother, a friend, a relative, colleague, and sometimes a few other unmentionable names. But to us, he was always just Dad. He was someone that we thought would be around for a lot longer. To sum up what he meant to us in a few words, paragraphs, is actually impossible. We didn't always agree with him, especially as we grew into young ladies, mature women, mothers as us, ourselves. Sometimes we were actually too alike, different. Each of us embody characteristics of Daddy, you know, that he would from time to time tell us, you're like me, you sound like me, you do this like me, you know. And we let him have that. Growing up with Daddy wasn't always easy. I don't think any family life is easy. Nothing is ever really easy, but in truth, Daddy knew that we loved him. Daddy taught me to be intentional and purposeful about everything we do with the time that God gives us on this earth. And with that, particularly towards the end, while Daddy struggled with his mental health, when Daddy became a man that most people did not know or recognize, when there were no more words, I reassured Daddy continuously. I love you, I love you, and I love you. You are special and the world needs to know you, Daddy. And for everybody that has the honor of knowing you, their life is made better. We love Daddy, but God loved him more, and God saw it fit to deliver him from the strife and struggles of this world. So with that, we honor his memory. We continue to pray that his soul has found its rest, and we continue to live on his legacy through ourselves and our children. And we are honored, as I began, to be in the presence of all these people who think and thought so fondly of our dad and serve as constant reminders of the magnitude of a human being that he was. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Hello, you guys. I know this family for years, and there's always pleasant people. Simon used to be my boss, believe it or not, when he used to sell those lovely pots that Robert spoke about. And I must say, he wasn't a bad boss. And he's always, you know, like everybody has said, no need to repeat, everything they said about Simon is true. And And I sing this song for the family. I pray that you all be blessed and be encouraged. That God has you in his hand. Thank you.
No need to fear of me standing here as well. It is our custom to collect a free will offering at times like these. I sat there and I looked at the program and I reminded myself, folks gathered here today might be wondering why so much singing. If you didn't know, Simon was a great singer. He loved music. He loves to sing. And personally, I used to enjoy listening to Simon singing. Not only here, but at work as well. He sings very well. I observe also and reminded myself that not the same year, but the same date. I see that he was born on the 28th of October, so was I. But the rest I'll keep to myself. And now we'll go to the offering. I just want to assure you, no need to fear. Just give as the Lord has blessed you. And I observe the song that the family has chosen while we collect the offering. It said, praise. Yes, praise him, I think is Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. So let us praise God by giving to help those that are less fortunate. It will go towards what we call the Good Samaritan Fund. So give with joy and assurance in your heart that God shall bless you abundantly. And if you are in doubt, prove him. He said so in Malachi chapter 3. Prove him now, here it said the Lord of hosts. Will the deacons and others collect the offering from us now as we give?
To bow your heads as we have a time of prayer. Heavenly Father, we pause in your presence this afternoon to know that you're a God who knows everything, You understand our infirmities and our weaknesses. And Lord, you know that we're living in a world of sin where we see the consequences of sin, death, suffering, pain, heartache, sadness, sorrow. Lord, we know that this was never your desire that we should experience any of this, but that you created us perfect to live a perfect life. But Lord, you created us with a choice, and man chose to rebel and to turn away from you. And now we see today the effects of that. Lord, we know that even when man sinned, you gave a way of hope for us. And you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, to pay the penalty of death for us, so that we can have the hope of eternal life. Lord, you declared the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. But Lord, I know that you are a compassionate Heavenly Father, and I know that you are near to your people at this time, and I especially want to pray for the family as they still come to terms with the loss of a father, a grandfather, a sibling, a friend. Lord, I just want to commit each one to you, Lord, of the family. You know how each one grieves differently. But Lord, you see every tear and you see every frown on the face and the heaviness of heart. And I pray, Lord, that you will draw near to them, each one. Comfort them, Lord, I pray. Father, you've heard their tributes that have been said today. And you see, Lord, the anguish in which they have done it and the tributes that have been said. But Lord, I pray that you, in the midst of their grief, will reveal to them that not only are you with them, but Lord, you have a way, you have a promise, and you've said, as we've said before, let not our hearts be troubled, you will come again. So Lord, I pray that you will help us, and in the midst of our grief, that you will help us to know that when someone dies in the Lord, that we don't need to grieve as those who have no hope, for our hope is in Jesus Christ. So thank you for the blessed hope, Lord, of the assurance of a resurrection to come, the newness of life that will take place, and all things will be new. And what assurance it will be, Father, when the next voice that Simon hears will be the voice of his Lord and Savior, calling his name. And not only that, but he will see his Savior as well. This is the promise and belief that we have because of his love for you. And so may we take this comfort and hope to know that yes, weeping will endure for the night, but the promise of joy will come in the morning. We pray this, Father, and we thank you for the assurance that one day soon we will see you face to face. And what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and we will shout the victory. May this be all our song as we comfort and support the family today. In Jesus' name, amen.
When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Shall we all stand now as we sing our closing hymn. Yeah. Loving Father, we pause a bit longer in your presence. I want to give you thanks for the service rendered. I want to thank you for your presence with us. We have just sung the hymn, "When We All Get to Heaven, What a Day of Rejoicing That Will Be." We're asking, O Lord, that you will be with us in a special way, that none of us will be turn aside when you shall come, but we will be there, and there we shall meet our brother again. We thank you for the promises in your words. We are glad and happy to know that you are the resurrection and the life, and nothing is impossible for you. So, Father, again, we thank you for all that you have done for us. We thank you for the life of the young man. And we ask that his family will so live that they will see him again in the earth made new. Where according to your words, there'll be no more separation, no more death, no more crying, no more pain. And we say to God be the glory. Father, again, we pray that you will bind us all together with the cords of love cannot be broken. And when you shall come to claim your own, may each and every one of us in the hearing of my voice be able to go home to spend eternity with you. This we ask with the forgiveness of all our sins in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, you may be seated.
By the river. Thank you. Zion. It's been long, a long time coming, but I know my change gonna come. Whoa, yes it will.
Others who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live, and whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Okay.
Set, gentlemen.
For as much as it has pleased our Heavenly Father in his wise providence to take unto himself our beloved Simon Edwards, we therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God in our Savior Jesus Christ, who shall change the body of our humiliation and fashion it anew in the likeness of his own body of glory, according to the working of his mighty power, wherewith he is able to subdue all things unto himself.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Ask everyone just to as we pray. Our loving Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for these scriptures of assurance, of promise, and of hope. Assurance, Lord, that one day soon you will put an end to death and suffering and pain and sorrow as we see it every day. Hope in the coming of the Lord and in the hope of a resurrection, that those who die in the Lord will be raised again in newness of life. Father, it is because of the hope that we have in you that gives us the desire and the burden and the willingness, Lord, to live on, because we know that something better will happen one day soon. And so, Lord, we're living in a time when we see so much negative things taking place and hatred and envy and, of course, ultimately death, but something better will soon happen. And Lord, we know right now that we're around this resting place of Simon and our hearts are heavy and we feel the grief of loss, but something better will soon happen. And I know, dear Father, that that something better will be when you will finally say it is finished, and death will be no more, and heartache will be no more, and all things will be made new. And we think, Lord, of the words of promise that's given to us in John 21, that says that when he looked, he saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down, adorned like a bride for her husband. And he saw a new heaven and a new earth. And I thank you, Lord, for that vision of hope, because that is what keeps us going. And even in times like this, we can still be assured that we have a Savior who is coming back to take us home. So, Father, I pray that as Simon rests in this place, Lord, we know that he is resting in peace. We know that he made his decision for you. And you are the great judge. You know everything. And you see things that nobody else sees. We see on the outside, but you see in the heart. And so, Lord, I thank you that your ways are not our ways and your thoughts are not our thoughts. And you are higher and greater than what we could ever think or imagine. And so, Lord, I pray that as he resides here, Lord, that you will mark the spot where he rests. I pray, Lord, that on that resurrection day, Lord, that the angels will come and there will be a great reunion, a great transformation where the mortal will put on immortality and corruption will put on incorruption and he will be changed. Father, may this not be only Simon's experience, but maybe everyone's experience here today. May we all have that place where we can see you face to face. And so now I pray, Lord, that you will just draw near to the family, the loved ones who are here, those who knew Simon the most, those who knew him, those who understood him, those who spent time with him, those who loved him, those who were born from him, those who gave birth to him, those, Father, who are just here today because he meant something special. I pray, Father, that you will be with each one, Lord, and I pray that you will help us, that in our grieving we will also support each other. And may, Lord, this funeral service indeed be a celebration of his life that we can look back on and truly do so with fond memories, memories that will never fade. May this be our desire, Lord, that nothing will take away those memories. And now, Father, may your name be praised and honored and glorified, even in this sad time. We lift your name on high, and we thank you, Lord, for his life and for his legacy that will live on in our lives as we live on this earth. Now may your anointing and your blessing be upon all of us here tonight, today, as we stay around this resting place. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, this time we can sing some songs.
Jesus is coming soon. This is the choir right here. And we're singing for Brother Simon. We're coming with the glory shall rise. We have a hope in Christ.
Let me not pay. I'm going to Jesus. everyone. What a wonderful. We're going to have a little closing prayer now, and then we're going to head back to the hall. Okay, so we're going to ask Elder Henry to say a closing prayer.
Thank you, dear Father, for the way that you have been instrumental in shaping his life. We pray for the family in a marked way, and all those who have contributed to his life to make him the person that he was. We thank thee, dear Father, that no amount of time can erase the legacy that he has left behind. And we walk, dear Father, and as we leave this place, help us to remember that the best way to honor a person's legacy is to respect his wishes. Amen. We thank you, O God, that as the family move to their various places of abode, may his memory live on as a man who loved God, a man of principle, a man who knows what it is to serve God with all his heart, because in the end, that is the only bit that we can take from this planet called Earth. So as you mark the spot where our dear brother lay, when you shall burst the clouds of heaven with all the holy angels with you, may you remember Simon, not for where he was born, but for how he lived. Hear and bless us, sanctify and keep us, is a prayer in the mighty name of Jesus. And let the church say amen, because even in death, God is still good.